Thank you, Ben, for that kind introduction and for the opportunity to talk to you today about some of the work that we do at the National Minerals Information Center at the U.S. Geological Survey. So what I would like to do today is to start off by giving some general background, which may be perhaps obvious to some of you, but is, I think, generally not well known to the general public. First, I think it's important to note that modern technology makes use of virtually the entire periodic table of elements. Even a single artifact like the cell phone contains several dozen elements, in this case, 38 were analyzed in this example, including elements that previously had little or no application, major applications. Of course, it's not just about consumer electronics. These exotic elements are used in everything from energy generation, including renewable energy technologies such as thin film solar photovoltaics and direct drive wind turbines, in healthcare, including biomedical devices, anti-cancer drugs, diagnostic imaging equipment, in national defense applications, whether it's rhenium for single crystal turbine blades or night vision goggles, or in transportation, of course, like the electric vehicles that are coming online and becoming much more important. This list is, of course, by no means exhaustive, but gives you a sense of how these elements now find use in virtually every aspect of our daily lives, whether we realize it or not. Now, to meet demand for these new technologies, production has of course had to increase. For base metals that may have been used for a millennia, that growth has been steady and constant. Here I'm showing the production of several metals since 1975, so their values are normalized to 1975 production at one. And you can see, for example, the production of zinc has more than doubled, the production of copper has nearly tripled, and bauxite, the production of bauxite has almost quadrupled. As a reference, world GDP adjusted for inflation has a little more than tripled. Now, in contrast, some of the minor metals have increased much more notably. For example, rhenium's production has increased almost 12-fold, indium's production 16.5-fold, and gallium a whopping almost 43-fold. Now, these elements I picked not randomly. If you look at them closely, you'll notice that the three that are in the yellowish shades are actually byproducts of the ones in the blue shades. So we get gallium as a byproduct of bauxite, indium as a byproduct of zinc, and rhenium as a byproduct of molybdenum and copper. And so what this suggests is that, you know, how could this possibly happen if the production of these sort of host metals has only doubled or quadrupled, and these minor metals have increased tens of folds? Well, that suggests that maybe previously we weren't recovering some of these minor metals in significant quantities, and now we are recovering them. But it also suggests that this trend is potentially not sustainable, in the fact that at some point we're going to recover everything that there is, and the production of the base metals will have to increase as well. So there's that dynamic going on. Now, of course, gallium, indium, and rhenium are not the only byproduct metals. This is a study we did back in 2015 where we analyzed, you know, what percentage or what share of each element's primary production is obtained as a byproduct. And you can see there's something on the order of like 38 or so elements that we analyzed have at least half of their production being produced as a byproduct. Another issue to consider is the concentration of production. I think it's maybe obvious to a lot of people, but not to everybody, that mineral resources, like any other type of natural resource, is neither uniformly nor randomly distributed on Earth. As a result of that and other factors, such as, of course, economics and policy, production is highly concentrated in a few countries. Here I'm highlighting 9 countries and their share of each element's global production for those countries. So you can see some countries like Brazil dominate a few elements like niobium. Chile dominates several more, rhenium, copper, lithium, DRC, Congo, Kinshasa dominates tantalum and cobalt mine production. The United States has a few more, beryllium and helium. South Africa dominates the platinum group metals, as well as vanadium, chromium, and manganese. Canada has a little bit of everything, Russia as well. And then we have China, which essentially today dominates everything else. So you can see this concentration of production, of course, leads to another concern, which is the fact that not every country has everything that it needs. So this is what we call as net import reliance. We do this analysis on an annual basis in our mineral commodity summary publication. This is from the 2017 publication. Our 2018 publication will be out later this month, so look for that. But basically what it highlights is all the commodities that the United States is highly import reliant on, and that number has been growing, or something on the order of 50 commodities over 50% import reliant at this point. So that number is large and has been growing. So if you think about all these concerns, it sort of begs the question of, well, okay, so we have a number of different concerns regarding concentration of production, increasing demand. There are other things that I didn't mention, like limited or no recycling at the end of life. They all draw the conclusion of that there's potential concern for a supply disruption. And so there are a number of assessments typically referred to as criticality assessments to try to examine this issue. This is not something new. It's been done at least since the 1950s. More recently, in 2008, the National Research Council put out a report that provided a basic framework for analyzing criticality, which my former group at Yale and I have helped to flesh out and apply. And of course, the European Commission has also adopted the methodology for their own needs. Since coming to the U.S. Geological Survey, we, as part of the National Science Technology Council, have taken a somewhat different approach than to do a straight-up criticality assessment. What we've tried to do instead is try to look at a number of indicators and try to look at trends over time to highlight things that are potentially changing that might be problematic. So things that we look at are some of the things that I've already mentioned: the concentration of supply in countries of low governance, the increase of production as a proxy for increasing demand and increasing importance, and price volatility to examine the stability of the market. So we look at all these factors and come up with a single indicator that's normalized to a common 0 to 1 scale. We look at it over time to see if we can highlight trends and concerns. And so these are the results in periodic table format. So you can see a couple of things right away. Elements like copper, silver, and gold, their values are relatively low and consistently low. Others are consistently high, such as the minor platinum group metals like ruthenium and rhodium. And then others still are rapidly increasing in their what we call criticality potential values, such as gallium, one of the main byproducts that I previously mentioned. Another thing that I think this is helpful for is to identify things before they happen. So one thing that we, for example, looked at was the rare earths, and to see, you know, could we have captured that issue before it happened? And in fact, we possibly could have. Using these simple indicators, we could have seen a problem starting to happen in the early 2000s and well before any of the disruption that happened in later on. So this is work that we did and published in 2016. We've updated in 2017, and we plan to continue to update it on a somewhat regular basis. But so once a criticality assessment is completed, the question is, okay, so you've identified the commodities that are perhaps of most concern. Then the question is, okay, well, what can be done about it, or what should be done about it? And I think for us, the way we try to approach this is we first want to try to understand, well, how is this resource essentially being managed once it's been mined? So what happens to it? How much is being mined? Where is it being used? In what applications is it used in? How much is recycled? How much is lost during use? How much is lost after use? And so this is an example from a study that we recently did on tantalum. So these are global tantalum flows. Everything is in tantalum content metric tons for the year 2015. Starting from the left, the production you can see is dominated by the Great Lakes region in Africa, in DRC and Rwanda. Goes through primary production, processing, which is the equivalent of a smelter, manufacturing. So these are original equipment manufacturers. Through the use phase, so these are actual consumers using this tantalum containing finished goods, and then, you know, what happens to them after use, after they've been potentially discarded, and then the flows that you see at the bottom are recycling flows at the different life cycle stages. So we tried to take a holistic approach. We look at the entire life cycle from primary production all the way to end of life, and try to understand what's going on with the commodity throughout its life cycle. So this is just for a snapshot in time, but if you look at it over several years, you can see some trends. And so here I'm showing that same figure for several different decades, 1995, 2005, and 2015. And you can see how things have changed over time for tantalum. In 95, for example, a significant amount of tantalum was recovered out of tin slag. In 2005, Australia was the dominant producer, and now it's shifted to Rwanda and DRC. On the use side, tantalum was significantly used, of course, in capacitors, it still is, but as well as mill products and carbides. That's shifted now to a significant amount of tantalum being used in chemicals and alloy additives and sputtering targets. A lot of those end up being used in electronics. So what does that mean, and what kind of trends can we look at? Well, in general, we can look at different recycling rates and two different indicators for recycling. One is recycled content. So this is the amount of tantalum that's flowing to the manufacturer that has been recycled at some point, whether it's new scrap from the manufacturers or old scrap. And you can see that's sort of hovered between 20 and 35% recycled content for tantalum. The end-of-life recycling rate, which is essentially a metric of how much of the tantalum that's coming out of use actually was recycled, has actually declined since the 1990s, at least based on these modeled estimates, from a high of perhaps 25% recycling rate down to around 18% today. And the major reason for that is, again, the shift from things that are heavily recycled, such as carbides and mill products, to things that are not, namely electronics at the end of life. And so you can look at different metrics and try to understand, well, what is going on? What are sort of the hotspots? What are the areas that we can sort of tackle in terms of reducing our risk for supply disruption? Now, everything that I've mentioned here for tantalum is looking at flows, but you can aggregate the flows to look at stocks to get a better sense of what is the status of a commodity above ground. And so that's what this waterfall diagram is looking at. So I have, for example, we've mined something on the order of 50,000 plus metric tons of tantalum since 1970. Most of that is from tantalum mineral concentrates. A significant amount, however, is also from tantalum tin slag. We've lost quite a bit in simple processing. There's quite a bit in industry stocks or unaccounted for. That leads us to how much is entered the manufacturing stage net of any recycling. So we call that demand net of recycling. We can subtract out the amount that's been lost during manufacturing. There's been a little bit of loss during use. So these are carbides that get wear and tear. So you lose a little bit during use. Some of the superalloys are downgraded. So you can think about that superalloys being downgraded to other types of steels. And so you lose the functionality of the tantalum. But the majority of the losses have been at the end of life. So these are discarded products that are no longer in use. They actually may still be, they may not have been discarded, but they're no longer in use. So you can think about these as somebody's cell phone sitting in a drawer somewhere. It's not been tossed, but it's no longer in use. So these we typically call as hibernating stocks. But what we're left with is about 21% of all tantalum that's been mined since 1970 is still in use today, about half of that as in capacitors. And so this gives you a sense of you know, where is tantalum, what's its status above ground, what is it still used in today. Now, this is done globally, but you can imagine doing a similar study for individual countries, and various colleagues of ours have done that. And you can see, you can compare, for example, what is the stock of tantalum above ground versus below ground. A recent study that's come out of Europe, I believe by a group in Leiden University, looked at aluminum reserves for various countries, and what ends up, what one of their results show is that there's more aluminum reserves in the United States above ground than there is contained in bauxite in geological reserves. So that's an interesting finding that's probably not very common yet, but as demand for these commodities grow, sort of the reserves of these commodities that might be called in urban mines might be shifting depending on where the uses are, from below ground and being dispersed to uses above ground in different countries. For tantalum, what we also found is that if you were to recycle the amount that's coming out of use every year on an annual basis, the amount that's coming out of use from carbides, if it was entirely recycled, from capacitors, if it was recycled completely, would be more than the amount that's currently mined in DRC or Rwanda. So that sort of gives you perspective on the numbers that's coming out of use on an annual basis. Of course, economics plays a huge role in what is or isn't recycled. So everything that I've talked about so far is sort of looking at what's going on today, or maybe what's going on in the recent past. But we also try to look at things going to the future, and we do that using scenarios. So what we found is that there's a significant amount of uncertainty regarding a new and emerging technologies. So it's hard to put numbers with any sort of significance unless you do some sort of scenario analysis. So here's an example of a paper that we recently did looking at renewable energy technologies and byproduct metals required for those. Specifically here, I'm showing annual requirements for tellurium in US CadTel photovoltaics up to the year 2040 under various scenarios. And you can see the results vary considerably depending on the scenario. Here we're looking at whether or not the clean power plan was adopted or not. We're looking at uncertainties regarding the market share of that technology. We're also looking at uncertainties regarding the material intensity. So how much tellurium is required per megawatt of capacity. And what you can see from these two figures is that the results vary considerably, but under the more aggressive scenarios, the demand for tellurium could be a significant part of current global production. And so that's something to watch out for. A follow-up study is looking at the supply side to try to understand, well, how much more tellurium could be recovered from copper anode slimes. And based on preliminary results, it looks like it could be significant. So we believe that, we need to look at the past to understand what's going on. We need to understand what's going on above ground. We also need to develop scenarios to look at what's going on in the future. So with that, I will summarize. A combination of trends and issues, we believe, raise concerns regarding the reliability of supply for certain non-fuel mineral commodities. We've developed an early warning screening as part of the National Science and Technology Council to try to help to identify minerals that are perhaps of most concern. Doing assessments of minerals throughout their life cycle, all the way from mining to end of life, we believe provides foundational knowledge regarding that commodity and helping reduce that supply risk. And we believe using scenario analysis can help us determine or tackle the uncertainties of what demand might be and supply might be in the future, and to help inform policy or inform strategies, corporate strategies, to try to address those uncertainties.